Hi, you might remember this Rohde Schwarz HMO1202 series scope that I did a tear down and play around with quite a few years ago. And I actually I got this out and I was playing around with it yesterday, and I forgot how much I really liked this thing. It's small, it's compact, it's light, it boots up quick. The fan noise is virtually practically zero, and it's got some really nice features. And my one here is a 300 megahertz jobby. It's got mixed signal, it's got pattern gen, and it's got a function gen built in, and I think component tester and all sorts of stuff. And it's got really good FFT, and I love the quick view mode on it. I'll show you that in a second. And I've forgotten how much I love this thing, so I might actually use this as my daily driver. But there is one problem, and sometimes I just completely forget that I've done a video in the past. No, it's not old age, it's just, I don't know, some videos stick in my mind and some don't. And I had completely forgotten that I did a teardown, well, I knew I did a teardown of this, but I completely forgotten that I did like a hack-in video of this, actually looking at the SPI signals that are controlling the front-end gain chip in here, and that's how they actually get the bandwidth, because this is software bandwidth. The base unit is 50 megahertz, and it goes up to 300 megahertz, and that's all in software. And they do that by sending SPI commands through to the front chip amplifier on here. I forget the part number, but yeah, that's how they do the software bandwidth. I completely forgotten that I'd done that video. Anyway, I'll link it in up here if you haven't seen that hacking video. It was rather interesting. But anyway, I was playing around with this thing again, and I noticed something that, well, is not right. You'll notice I got channel 1, channel 2 here, but channel 1's one millivolt per division. It's got a low noise front end. It's looking pretty schmick. But channel 2, it's 50 millivolts. Let's actually turn that down here. Bueller, what's going on here? Now, here's this feature I told you about, the quick view feature. This is one of the things I really like about this. Look at that. You just press the quick view and it just pops up. Unfortunately, it does get rid of channel 1. It gets rid of the channel that you're not currently engaged in. It actually disables it. So I'm not sure whether... I assume the trigger would still work, I guess. I don't know if they've done that for like a screen clarity reason, or whether that's a process in bottleneck thing. I don't know. Anyway, yeah, I love how it just automatically puts up like everything you need to know and how they do it on screen. It'd be nicer if I could actually get that bigger, but I can't, unfortunately. And the other thing I don't like is that you can't push to go center here, but you know, can't have everything. But yeah, anyway, nice, but why? Why am I getting this? This is obviously 50 hertz. Just look at the time base there. And, well, it tells you here, doesn't it? Yeah, 50 hertz. There you go. So I'm getting all this 50 hertz noise. So I think I've completely come-a-gutsa, and I've forgotten to put the shield, when I reassembled this, the shield back on channel 2. It's got to be. There's no other reason why we'd be picking up 50 hertz like that. So let's tear this thing down, and I think we'll find that the shield is missing. Oops. So let's have a squiz. I've got these 6 screws out of this puppy, and yeah, memory serves me correctly, that just pops off there. And no, both cans are in position. What's on the bottom? No, that's the trigger. That's the trigger channel. Because one of the things I don't, one of the things that annoys me on this is that they're putting the external trigger here and channel, like, the external trigger should be, like, all the way over this side physically. It's just, I always plug in the channel 1 into the wrong one. I plug it into the external trigger. Yep, there it is. Yep. Yeah, you can see where that was soldered in there. I have not put the can back on, so wah. Yeah, I don't think there's any chance of me finding that shield now, because this was like 4 or 5 years ago or something. This is quite a long time ago. They've since updated this model, by the way. It's now the RCM or something. There's a C in there or something. 1000 model, which looks and feels almost identical, but it doesn't have the 50 ohm input. One of the things I like about this thing is that it does have actually a switchable 50 ohm input, which not even my RTB2000 model has, which is, I don't know, three times the price of this thing. So this is like a really great little scope. I love it. I'm going to have to manufacture some sort of can. I don't know. Does anyone know? Are there any like prototype services out there? I mean, I guess I could take, I've got to desolder this. I don't know why they soldered them in there. I guess from vibration, they want to stop them falling out or something, but they did solder it in one corner. I guess I could take that out, get all the measurements and whatnot. I could probably do it without that. But yeah, anyway, if anyone knows, can you get like, is there a really cheap and simple prototype service out there for, I think one of the manufacturers does it. That's not mu metal. I don't think this is magnetically shielded. But in either case, it doesn't matter because we're not dealing with a magnetic interference here. We're dealing with electric. So just a regular shielding can. So I don't know. Maybe I can get some, I could bodge something, but I don't know. Let us know in the comments down below what you think the best way to replace a missing shield like this, because I want to try this as my daily driver scope, and I don't want that much crap on my second channel, thank you very much. So leave it in the comments. Anyway, catch you next time.